Hi all, today we are going to discuss about mowing iron instruments. So mowing iron instruments are most widely used instruments for both laboratory and switchboard applications for as an ammeter up to 50 amperes and as a voltmeter up to 750 volts for both DC as well as AC up to 120 hertz frequency. Because above this frequency some issues will come, so this I will discuss in the next class, the errors in the instruments. So because they are relatively cheap for the required accuracy when compared to any other type of instruments which you are going to discuss in the coming lectures. So these moving iron instruments can be classified into two categories. One is the attraction type and second one is the repulsion type. So first one is the attraction type. It is the simplest type, but practically this is not used. Practically only repulsion type is used, but for understanding the concept, this attraction type is very easy to understand. So that's why let us start with the attraction type moving iron instrument. So this is simple basic working principle. Let us assume I made a winding like this. So this is nothing but this is called as a solenoid. So whenever you make the winding like this and you pass the current, so you can get the direction of the flux by using the right hand thumb rule, where your curled finger indicates the direction of the current, then your thumb indicates the direction of the magnetic field. That means your magnetic field will be coming out like this. So from this side the flux will come out. So this will act as a north pole and this will act as a south pole. That means the flux will return back like this one, or otherwise we can tell that the flux will pass like this. So flux will pass in this manner. So in this manner the flux will pass. So whenever the flux is passing in this manner, because you can see this iron vane is placed near to the electromagnet or near to the magnet, it get magnetized due to this magnetic field. So because it get magnetized, it will be attracted towards the magnet. It will be attracted towards the electromagnet. This is the basic working principle for this. Or in otherwise we can tell that why only any iron material is attracted when a magnet is kept near to that. So always the magnetic field want to pass through the low reluctance path. So in order to pass through the low reluctance path, because the reluctance of air is very high when compared to reluctance of the metal, so that's why it preferred to pass through the metal. But in order to pass through the metal, it has to pass through the long journey, so automatically reluctance is more. So what it can do, either it should move towards this metal object or metal object is attracted towards this magnet. So when the metal object is moved nearby, so the reluctance offered for the passage of flux will decrease. So that's why when an iron material is kept near to the magnet or electromagnet, it will be attracted towards that magnet. This is the basic working principle. So let us see practically how this will be designed. So in this case, what will be there? One soft iron vane is attached to the spindle. So the spindle will be there. So it is fixed at this position and remaining part can move freely. And to the same spindle, the pointer will be attached and the damping and the controlling, all these things are attached to the spindle only. So whatever solenoid I have shown the cross sectional area here, this is the coil. So whenever the current is passing through this coil, it gets magnetized. So magnetic field is produced. Whenever the magnetic field is produced, now this soft iron bar is attracted by this electromagnet. So the soft iron bar will be attracted into this hollow type of solenoidal coil. So it will be attracted inside. So when it is attracted, it will move in such a way as to increase the flux of the electromagnet. That is, the vane occupies the position of minimum reluctance. So this force produced is always in such a direction so as to increase the inductance of the coil. Because inductance is inversely proportional to the reluctance, so it will be moved in such a way as to increase the inductance of the coil. So now this iron vane is attracted inside. When this iron vane is attracted, as this vane is attached to the spindle, so spindle will rotate. When the spindle is rotated, the pointer will start moving. This is the basic technique based on which the torque is produced. I am repeating once again, whenever the coil gets magnetized, it produces the flux. And when the flux is produced, that electromagnet or the flux produced by this electromagnet will magnetize the soft iron core and it will attract the soft iron core towards that. Or we can tell that soft iron core will move in such a way, it will increase the inductance of the coil. It will move towards it so that it will decrease the reluctance. So whenever the soft iron core is attracted towards this one, then the pointer will move because it is attached to the same spindle. So now in order to produce a required controlling torque, so that controlling torque will be provided either by using the control, we can go for helical springs or we can go for the gravity based control. But gravity based control, we have seen the disadvantage is it should be used only in the vertical position, whereas spring control, that problem is not there. So that's why practically we go for the control springs only to produce the control torque. So whenever the control torque is equal to deflecting torque or the attraction torque, torque produced because of attraction of the soft iron vane, at that position your pointer will settle down. And in order to settle this pointer in the final deflection position at a very faster rate, we have to go for the damping also. So the damping will be provided by air friction damping. So in the case of moving iron instrument, only air friction damping is used, eddy current damping is not used. Because the reason is, in this case, because the you can see the magnetic field is mainly produced by the electromagnet only, and because of this electromagnet, this get magnetized and attracted. So in this case, the magnitude of the field will be very less. So as the field is very less, so if you want to produce the eddy current damping, because eddy current damping we have seen there, it needs the permanent magnets. But this is the electromagnet only. Because we need the permanent magnet there, we have to install one more magnet. So now that magnetic field can interfere with this magnetic field and create the errors. That is the major disadvantage of this one. And second one, because of that magnetic field, there is a chance that some losses also may happen in this iron spindle. So that is the reason the eddy current damping is not used in practice. For the case of moving iron instruments, we always go for air friction damping. I am repeating once again. So in practice, only air friction damping is used for the moving iron type of instrument, whichever type of instrument you use. Eddy current damping is not used because eddy current damping needs a separate permanent magnet. So that magnetic field may interfere with the electromagnet magnetic field. Because in this case, the magnetic produced by this electromagnet will be very less, and that may be affected due to the permanent magnet. That's why that is not used in practice. And second one, even the torque produced is less. So this air friction damping is sufficient to dampen the oscillations. So I hope this is clear to you. So this is the side view of this one. So this spindle, will be like this. So this will be connected on both sides to jewel bearings. And two springs are used. One spring is wound in clockwise, another spring is counterclockwise direction. So these two together will produce the required control torque. And why they are wound in opposite direction is already taught in previous lectures. So I am not repeating here. So this is the iron vane and this is my coil. So whenever this coil gets magnetized, the iron vane will be attracted towards that. So you can see here, irrespective of the direction of current through this coil, this iron vane will be magnetized always, and it will be always attracted towards the coil. Whether the magnetic field like this side north pole, this side south pole is coming, or this side north pole, this side south pole is coming, both cases this soft iron is always attracted. So that's why it is independent of type of the current passing through the same thing. So whatever I have discussed, same thing I have repeated. So I am just reading once again. So the coil is wound as a solenoid, and when the current is passed through the coil, it produces the magnetic field and attracts the moving soft iron vane. So the iron vane moves in such a way as to increase the flux of the electromagnet. That is, vane occupies the position of minimum reluctance. Thus, the force produced is always in such a direction so as to increase the inductance of the coil, because inductance is inversely proportional to the reluctance of magnetic circuits. And here the damping is produced by the air friction damping, and the controlling torque is generally provided by the springs, one spring control only, because gravity control is sometimes used in vertically mounted instruments, but spring control is better than the gravity control in practice. So now the operating magnetic field is very weak. I told you it will be of the order of 0.00622, 0.0075 webers per meter square. So eddy current damping cannot be used. The reason is, permanent magnet used for eddy current damping may disturb the operating magnetic field. That is the reason. So now going to the repulsion type moving iron instrument. So here this works on the principle of not attraction, it works on the principle of repulsion. So in order to produce the repulsive force, two vanes are placed inside the coil. One vane is fixed and the other vane is movable. So they are similarly magnetized when the current passes through the coil, and hence there is a force of repulsion between the vanes. So in order to understand this, let us proceed further. There are basically two types of ways in which we can obtain this repulsion type instrument. First one is the radial vane type. So in this case, what will be there? You can see here, this is my spindle. So this is the top view from this. This is the spindle. To the spindle, one iron vane is attached, soft iron vane. This is the soft iron vane, and another vane is attached to the coil itself. You can see it is attached to the coil itself. So whenever the coil is magnetized, depending on the magnetic field, the both these iron parts, that means both this movable vane as well as the fixed vane will get magnetized. So both will be magnetized with the same polarity. We know that when the two magnets of same polarity are placed adjacent, they will be opposing each other. This is basically based on that principle. So now as the fixed vane cannot move, because of the repulsion force between these two, the movable vane will move away. Because you can see that movable vane is moving radially, that's why it is called as a radial type. That's why it is called as radial type. So for one particular instant is mentioned here, let us assume for a particular instant, upper side is north pole, lower side is south pole is induced in this one. Same will be induced in this one also, so there is a repulsion force. After half cycle, upper side becomes south, lower side becomes north. So this also will be reversed. So that's why always the force will be repulsion in irrespective of polarity of the current passing through the coil. So that's why unidirectional torque is produced in this case also. So now, the second type is the coaxial vane type. So coaxial vane type, both are in the same axis. You can see here, this is the fixed vane which is attached to the coil. This is the movable vane which is attached to the spindle. And you can see both are placed in such a way, both forms the sections of coaxial cylinder. So this will be part of one cylinder. This will be of also if the shape of the cylinder. So you can see here, this fixed vane shape is not simple of straight line type. You can see here, the width is more. As we go, the width will goes on decreasing. So the purpose of doing this is to provide the uniform scale. So how the uniform scale is obtained and how to do this, so that we are going to discuss in the next section in today's lecture only. So now coming to the control torque. So control torque is as usual like before, it is produced by the spring control, and the damping will be provided by air friction damping. I think up to here it is clear to you. So now when this coil get magnetized, so both this fixed vane and moving vane are magnetized with the same polarity, so both have the repulsive force. Because of the repulsive force, this moving vane is pushed away. So because of that, the moving vane will start moving like this. So when the moving vane is moving, automatically the pointer attached to this spindle will move and produce the required deflection. So here you have to remember that for moving iron instrument, irrespective of polarity of the current, both the vanes are magnetized with the same polarity. Therefore, there is always a force of repulsion between the vanes. So moving iron instruments are called as, because of this reason, unpolarized instrument. This is some of the interview question. Moving iron instruments are unpolarized instrument. The unpolarized means they doesn't depend on the polarity. That means they can be used both for AC and DC. Whereas moving coil instrument are polarized instrument, that means they can work for only particular direction of the current. That means they can be used only for DC. So now, attraction type instrument usually have a lower inductance than the corresponding repulsion type of instruments, and hence they are more accurate for wide range of frequency. So when the inductance is less, how it is used for wide range of frequencies, this will be discussed in the next class in detail. Because of time constraint, I am not discussing this. Tomorrow I will make the derivation for the same. So, this is having advantage, it can be used for wide range of frequencies. But the production cost of this attraction type instrument is more, and one more disadvantage is there, that is removed in repulsion type. In the case of repulsion type instrument, we can produce nearly uniform scale, and it is more economical to manufacture. Because of these reasons, in practice we always go for the repulsion type of instrument, because they are cheaper when compared to attraction type instruments. But limitation is there, they cannot be used for high range of frequencies, because we know our moving iron instrument generally we use for supply frequency, that is either 50 hertz or 60 hertz depending on the country. That's why there is no problem. So let us see the torque equation of the moving iron instrument. So when there is a small increment in the current supplied to the instrument, there will be a small deflection d theta, and some mechanical work will be done. In order to understand this, you can take the example. This is the diagram. When the current is passing through the coil, this becomes as an electromagnet. So because of this, this will attract the spindle. So when the spindle is attracted, the spindle will move like this. When the spindle is moved like this, your pointer will move in this direction. Your pointer will move in this direction. So let us assume that deflecting torque I am representing by TD, the torque that is produced due to attraction. So we can tell that the mechanical work that is done will be torque produced by the angular deflection. So this will be equal to TD multiplied by, let us assume the pointer is deflected by an angle of d theta. So whenever this iron bar is moved towards this electromagnet, automatically inductance of this electromagnet will change. So let us assume, due to the change in this displacement or due to moving of the soft iron vane, let us assume the inductance is changed from L to L plus DL. the inductance is changed from L to L plus DL. And let us assume, because this TD is produced because of change in the current only, so let us assume the current, initial value of the current is I, the current is changed from I to I plus DI. So correspondingly the theta is produced and the inductance is changed from L to L plus DL. So we can tell that the change in the stored energy, because both L is also changed now, current is also changed, automatically the energy stored also will change. So energy stored we know is equal to half into L into I square. So initial value is half Li square, and now because of the change of L and DI, it will become half times of L, become now L plus DL, I becomes I plus DI. So half L plus DL into I plus DA whole square minus half Li square. So this I plus DA whole square I can expand in this way, because now we have to multiply this one with this one and then subtract this one. So as the value of DI and DL are very small, so we can neglect the second and higher order terms in the quantities. That means wherever DI square, DL square, or DA multiplied by DL, so these type of things are coming, we can neglect them, because each one itself is very small, either the square or product will be much more small and can be neglected. So if you are neglecting those terms, it will become IL into DI plus half into I square DL. So that I am taking as equation number 3. So in order to increase the current by some value DI, so the applied voltage must increase, then only we can increase the current. So that's why we can represent that by E is equal to d phi by dt, that means the rate of change of the flux. And what is the flux? Flux I can write in the form L into I. So this I can write as a d by dt of Li. So d by dt of Li, here L is also variable, current is also variable, because I have shown that L inductance also changes. So this becomes I into dl by dt plus L into di by dt. I can expand in this form. So this E, if you want to calculate total electrical energy supplied, will be voltage multiplied by current multiplied by dt. That is the energy. So I am just multiplying this dt, I am taking to the second side. So this becomes E dt, and multiplying with I on both the sides, then it will become EI dt is equal to I square DL plus IL DI. Getting it? So this I am taking as equation number 5. So from the principle of conservation of energy, the electrical energy supplied will be equal to increase in the stored energy plus mechanical work done. So electrical energy supplied, we have just derived equation number 5, that is I square DL plus IL DI will be equal to, from equation number 3 we have seen that increase in stored energy is IL DI plus half times of I square DL, and mechanical work done will be TD into d theta. So from this I can calculate my value of TD will be equal to half times of I square into DL by d theta. Half times of I square into DL by d theta. So this I am taking as equation number 5. So I have told you, in practice we generally go for the spring control only. So TC is proportional to theta, that is the controlling torque, or we can tell that TC is equal to K theta. So at final deflection position, we know that TD will be equal to TC, at that position it will stop. So we can write K theta is equal to half times of I square into DL by D theta, or from this I can write theta is equal to half times of I square by K into DL by D theta. So if dl by d theta is constant, let us assume if dl by d theta is equal to constant, then theta will be proportional to current square. That means we can tell that as it is having the current square term, that's why it will have the unidirectional torque irrespective of sign of the current. Whether positive current or negative current, it will produce the unidirectional torque only. But the disadvantage is a square term is there, it will have the non-uniform scale. But in practice, the dl by dt is not constant, it will be variable. So now let us see how to make your scale the linear scale. So again, I am repeating equation number 6 here. Theta is equal to I square by 2k into dl by d theta. So if you can make it like such a way that dl by d theta is inversely proportional to theta. So we can write in this form, dl by d theta is equal to, this proportional I can remove by some constant. So I can write dl by d theta is equal to c by theta. I can write in this form, or otherwise I can tell that theta bringing second side, theta into dl by d theta is a constant. That means I have to design in such a way, theta multiplied by dl by d theta is equal to constant in that form. So let us see what will happen. So now I am substituting this equation number 7 and equation number 6. So then theta will be equal to I square by 2k is same. Now this dl by d theta is replaced by c by theta. So same thing I have replaced here. So from this theta cross multiplied, theta square is equal to I square c by 2k, or we can tell theta is proportional to the current. So we can observe here that theta is proportional to current, it become linear scale. That means scale can be made uniform if dl by d theta is inversely proportional to theta. Inversely proportional to theta. But in practice, there will be some problems that will be encountered. So, as per this formula, when theta is equal to 0, that means in the initial position, 1 by 0 means dl by d theta should be infinite. That means the change of inductance with respect to the theta should be infinite. But practically, that is not possible. So, that's why the scale near the 0 cannot be uniform. So, up to 10% of the full scale deflection angle, theta fs is full scale deflection angle. 10% of full scale deflection angle, it is non-uniform. That means dl by d theta will be nearly constant and it will not follow the rule, inversely proportional to theta. So after that, dl by d theta will be inversely proportional to the theta up to nearly 80%. So after that, dl by d theta decreases more rapidly. So that way we can conclude that for small values of theta up to 10% of theta fs, because the equation number 6 you can see, it is I square into dl by d theta. So equation number 6 you can see theta is equal to I square by 2k into dl by d theta. Dl by d theta is constant. That means theta is proportional to current square. As current is very less, so I square also will be very less. That's why for lower values of the current up to 10% of the scale value, it will have the compressed scale. So it will have the compressed scale. So for theta greater than 80%, so of theta fs, so dl by d theta decreases more rapidly. That means in that equation, when compared to the I square, dl by d theta, decrease in dl by d theta will be so much rapid, so that will counterbalance. So as a result of this, for higher end also there will be a cramped scale. That means the compressor scale will be there both in the lower end up to 10% and greater than 80% of the full scale deflection value in practice. Or we can tell that by making this modification, that means dl by d theta is inversely proportional to theta by proper design, uniform scale can be obtained from 10% to 80% of full scale deflection angle. So let us see the advantages and disadvantages and conclude here. So remaining things we will discuss in the tomorrow's class. So the advantages of moving iron instruments are, first one is it is having the robust construction and relatively cheaper when compared to other instruments, and this can be used for both for AC as well as DC. But the disadvantage is the scale is not uniform because it is cramped in both in the lower and the higher end, even by making the change in the design, and affected by stray magnetic fields as the operating field is very weak. There are hysteresis error due to losses in the vane of the instrument, because that vane of the instrument is made up of the iron, because that will have the hysteresis characteristic, so hysteresis error will introduce. So in order to avoid this, practically the vanes are made up of nickel iron alloy, so which will have the less hysteresis effect. Then the fourth one, it is having the poor sensitivity, and fifth one, the change in the frequency causes serious errors due to change in the inductance. So I am sure you might be having doubt in point number 3, point number 5 and point number 2. So these things will be discussed in detail in the tomorrow's lecture. I hope up to here whatever discussed are completely clear to you. If you still have any queries, you can leave your comments in the comment section below. I will answer to your queries from there. Thank you. Thank you very much.